We're very familiar with the idea that the laws of gravitation are universal. And so a lot of people in this room will study gravity by studying objects like black holes. I think probably there's some universal physics that explains life. Certainly as an astrobiologist, I hope that's true, because we need to be able to go to alien environments and detect on exoplanets things that we think are life. And we need to do it as an agnostic way as possible. So if we think that information is the foundational principle of life, there may be some laws of information that are universal. But if we want to understand the physics of those systems, we have to look at living systems, basically, as the sort of equivalent system to a black hole. Black hole is a really important manifestation of the laws of gravitation. A living system is a really important manifestation of the laws of information and how they operate in physical reality. So that's sort of like the base point. And so one of the things that comes from having this viewpoint is that life is not really this binary categorization of nature anymore. We don't think about a system as not being alive or as alive, but there's probably a gradation of states in between. And this gets into the idea of a life meter. So if we think that life is actually an objective property, I don't think that you guys need to observe me for me to be alive. So I don't think it's a subjective property. I think it's an objective property. Then we should be able to actually go and quantify and measure it. And so that's the goal. So I'm going to actually break my talk into talking about two related concepts and thinking about life quantitatively, which is something I've been working on with Michael Lockman at Santa Fe Institute. And this is actually supposed to say life does not equal alive, in the sense that when we're talking about life and we're talking about physics of life, we're conflating a lot of concepts. And I think a lot of the dialogue of how we should be thinking about life needs to be conceptually clarified. And so just to give an example of life, I would certainly consider this water bottle to be an example of life, or this pointer that I'm using for the clicker as an example of life. But they're not alive. And so what I mean by that is, if you wanted to specify the creation of a water bottle in the universe, it would require a process that has information about what a water bottle is to make it. I, as an individual, don't have that information, but certainly our society does, our civilization does. And so we don't expect a water bottle to spontaneously emerge with any kind of reliability or high probability without information to generate it. That's very different than me as a living entity. I'm alive in the sense that I'm actually a constructor. I can actually build things with information processing. And so that's sort of the dichotomy that we articulate in an essay that was published in Aeon magazine recently. But I want to kind of break that down into how what that looks like in terms of the kind of science and the ideas that we think about in my group. So obviously this is a really old question, and so Paul showed yesterday a slide with Schrodinger appealing to other laws of physics. I think that when we're thinking about the problem of what life is, there are certain useful conceptual tools that can be very clarifying. And so it was brought up on the free will panel about that I might have introduced some human-centric thinking talking about mathematics, and that's actually not my intention, but I do think that humans and the science we do is a really interesting manifestation of the physics of life, and it's a really conceptually clarifying one. So when I think about what life is, I like to look at these kind of examples that I have shown here to think about how that physics might operate. And so an analogy I often draw is to think about what it is for a planet to be launching satellites into space. So we certainly are a planet that's anti-accreting. We launch satellites all the time. If you think about anti-accretion rather than accretion as a planetary process, it's a process that requires a technological civilization with a specific kind of knowledge. It has to have knowledge about the laws of gravitation. Knowledge of the laws of gravitation is a knowledge about a regularity in the physical world. It's a kind of information. And when societies evolve that information, or when a biosphere basically acquires that kind of knowledge, it can control new processes like launching satellites into space. So the argument is that our planet would not be orbited by thousands and thousands of little metal boxes unless there was a kind of information that existed on the surface of our planet. And that's a clue to what the physics of life is. Another example comes from looking at the periodic table. I love examples of the periodic table these days, where they show all the different elements and all the kinds of physical processes in the universe that generate them. You'll notice that some of the highest atomic weight things that you can create are actually only creatable, as far as we know, by technology. And so then you have to think about technology again as a physical process. What is it? And so one of my favorite quotes with respect to this is one by David Deutsch, where he talks about the fact that base metals can be transmitted into gold by stars and by intelligent beings that understand the processes that power stars, and by nothing else in the universe, which really suggests that there's two kinds of physics. There's the objective reality that physics has gotten really good at explaining, and there's subjective or information processing systems that acquire knowledge about those regularities and then can control those processes. And that's what the physics of life is. And that's the physics we need to understand. So if we're thinking about quantifying life, in some way we want to understand how much of information from this perspective, this kind of causal perspective, has acquired on our planet over evolutionary timescales. And you probably could break the transitions into two major categories, the transition to life, when you had the origin of life, and the transition to intelligence and technology. And so one of the ways that I really like to think about these transitions is just to think about what's been happening in chemical space. Right, so as physicists, we're not really accustomed to thinking about what chemistry is as a physical system beyond like just quantum effects in chemistry and things. But what is chemistry in terms of the space of what can possibly exist? There's a lot of molecules that exist in meteorites and on prebiotic Earth. But if you think about the kinds of molecules that biology has created, there's many molecules that exist in biological systems with high abundance that we don't find anywhere else. And if you think about technology as one up on top of that, once we invented modern industry and things, we created a lot of molecules that wouldn't exist without that kind of intelligence or the need to generate those molecules. And so there is this kind of expanding set of possibilities that biology has created just within chemical space as a window into the physics. So Paul talked about this idea of the demonic cut, like basically where is it in physical reality that information becomes important? And so one argument is that this is really where the origin of life happens, or where the physics that governs original life becomes most apparent as the dominant physics. And so the way that I think about it is if you think you want to create, say, a molecule of a high complexity, it requires a lot of steps to synthesize that molecule. It's very unlikely, say, a protein of 200 amino acids, for that to ever be produced spontaneously and with high reliability, with high abundance. And so there is some sense that information is necessary to produce that molecule with any kind of abundance. And so we might be able to define a boundary in chemical space where it's actually necessary for information to create objects above a certain complexity. And that boundary is probably a little bit gray, because the boundary between non-life and life is not a hard boundary, but that's probably where we must insist that there was a living process that happened there, and we have to try to start figuring out where that boundary is, what that boundary looks like, and what the physics is operating to actually cross that boundary. And that would be the origin of life transition. So one way of thinking about trying to get at the mathematics of how to think about this demonic cut, or where is it the scale of complexity where information actually becomes necessary to explain the existence of an object, is a theory that I've been working on with collaborators in Glasgow. So this was actually something that Lee Cronin and colleagues there originally came up with. And so he's a chemist. He's really interested in chemical space. And one way to think about a molecule is the ways of assembling and disassembling a molecule. So there's many ways to assemble a molecule, there's many ways to disassemble a molecule. And so he came up with this idea of assembly pathways, which basically talks about all the ways of deconstructing an object is a way of understanding all the ways you could possibly build it. And so if we're thinking about this idea that life is necessary to construct some physical systems, like a water bottle, or like a complex molecule, you can talk about the assembly space, all the ways of making that thing, and then talk about a minimal path in that space. And so the argument is, if the pathway assembly is above a minimum length associated with requiring information to generate that object, it's a biological artifact. It must be indicative of life. So basically what we're trying to do is talk about a new kind of thinking about the space of biology as the space of possible objects that can exist, and thinking about each object intrinsically carrying with it a space of ways of assembling and disassembling that object. And then you can actually talk about a threshold when an object has actually crossed the boundary from when it required information to create it. Now, we don't know exactly where that boundary is, so we're doing two things. One is that in Lee's lab, they're actually looking for it in experimental systems, and they have pretty strong evidence that there is actually a firm boundary between when non-living systems can create molecules and above which only living systems can create them. So if you look in the assembly space below that cut, you probably can still have biological processes. They just wouldn't be definitively biological. And so this is just an example of how you think about assembly spaces in chemistry. And so one of the things that I think is really interesting implication of this is not a probabilistic framework, but I do think that we need to think probabilistically about how we're looking for life, and that we need to understand where is it in chemical space that we can look for things that are either artifacts or life, or where we might expect living structures like autocatalytic sets to emerge. And so one of the arguments that I've been trying to make with the origin of life community is that we actually need massive experiments to explore chemical space agnostically for lifelike processes. So for anybody in the room that's actually really familiar with origin of life literature, it's very dominated by people that want to make one particular molecule that's associated with life under prebiotic conditions. We don't get these kind of like massive experiments where we're just kind of looking for new properties in the universe in chemistry. And we really need that in order to be able to talk about what's the likelihood of life emerging from non-living chemistry. And one argument I make is actually this is going to be really critical for doing exoplanet science the right way, because we just don't know the prior probability of life. And so when I talk about this, I make an analogy with neutrino experiment Super Kamiokande, because here we're looking actually for proton decay, which is an event that we can bound the probability of. We've never observed it, but that allows us to say with what kind of frequency we might expect it to occur in the universe, which gives us some insights into new physical theories. Imagine if we had an equivalent chemical experiment where we're looking for life to emerge from chemistry, and we could at least bound the probability of that process, which would give us some insight into how real life is in chemical space and what kind of processes start to get on the path toward life. And these are the kind of experiments that might lead to that. So thinking about molecules and how you can actually, through steering by minerals being introduced in the environment, lead to different histories for complex chemistries that are actually statistically distinguishable and based on their history. So because I'm going to run out of time, I'm going to just speed on and talk about alive. And so I think this concept is quite interesting from the perspective of thinking about what is life to physics and how can we relate it to other hard problems. And so we're all pretty familiar in this room about the hard problem of consciousness. Paul and I also propose this idea of a hard problem of life, which is that consciousness is obviously concerned with our internal subjective experience. Life is concerned with how it is that information can affect reality. Right? So information is this abstract quantity. We don't really know how it's physically instantiated. And then we really need to understand how that operates in order to understand what life is. And so one way I've been trying to get that at this is actually to design experiments where we can actually physically emulate life. So people like to simulate life in a computer, but could we actually build a physical system that is indistinguishable in some ways from a living system? So if you think about decision-making process, for example, could you actually build a non-living system that makes a decision? Would you know it was alive or not? So it's a little bit like a philosophical zombie, but for life. And so one idea is if you want to think about physically simulating or emulating life or consciousness, you have physical system A and physical system B, you'd actually have to make an isomorphism between those two systems. So one thing that one of my students has been working on is trying to build automata that are isomorphic. So the picture on the left-hand side there is a state transition diagram. And what's shown on the right-hand side here is two automata that actually go through the same series of state transitions. And so they're isomorphic with respect to the state transition diagram as far as like the observables that we see. And so you'll notice that the top one has a feed-forward architecture with feedback, and the one below has an architecture without feedback. So one of the reasons we've been thinking about this is because in integrated information theory, feedback is actually really important. So if you could build a system that has the same series of state transitions, it would be an isomorphic philosophical zombie if it had only feed-forward architecture. And it turns out it's actually really possible to build such isomorphisms. They're fairly straightforward if you use something called Cronron's decomposition and do some math related to that formal theory of automata. And you can construct isomorphic systems that behave identically as far as the structure of their state transition diagram, but differ in the implementation of their logic. And so one of the things that we've been really interested in is that these architectures are not more efficient, they're not more autonomous, they have the same sequence of state transitions, and so the only difference that related to the integrated information is actually the logical architecture, which tells us something about different physical systems and their ability to instantiate certain computations, state transitions, and what the physical system is that represents it and its relation to integration. So we do some work thinking about information across non-living and living collectives, and this will connect to the idea of isomorphisms in just a minute. And so the behavior we've been looking at is ants actually do this pairwise behavior where one ant will follow another ant. And in the case of ants, this is actually a goal-directed behavior. The leader ant is trying to teach the follower ant how to get to a particular nest. And so they'll actually engage in this pairwise behavior to do that. So the idea here is that this is actually a learning behavior. As it turns out, termites also have a similar pairwise behavior, but it's not goal-directed, so it doesn't really have a purpose. The purpose actually there is fundamentally different. They are not goal-directed. They are doing exploration. And so if you want to compare a system with purpose to a system without purpose, you can actually do it very rigorously. They have the same behavior and try to think about what's the structure of information in systems with a purpose versus not. I don't usually talk about this in terms of purpose, but I think for this audience it's appropriate. And so what we do is actually track the trajectory of the ants and termites, and we turn it into time series data. And then we can do information theory on that time series. That allows us to look at the structure of the information flows between the leader ant and the follower ant. And when we do that, what we do is actually look at two channels called motion and rotation. So the motion is whether the ant is pausing or moving. The rotation is whether the ant is moving to the left or right. And what you'll see here is that for the two species of termite, which are C4 Mosanos and R. sporatus, those are the two species of termite, they differ in the information patterns than from the ants. When you break down the system into pausing versus rotation patterns, but not when you look at those together. And the main take home from this is basically that for the ants who have this goal-directed behavior, they have information flow in both directions. It's from the leader to follower as far as whether they're turning, but it's from the follower to leader as far as whether they're moving. But we don't see that for the termites, in part because they don't have this kind of goal-directed behavior. So you can actually see, even though they have the same pairwise collective behavior, that there's differences in the structure of their information flows distributed over space and time that's related to the actual function of that pair. And we see this across a bunch of different systems. So even for agents that are just simulated on a computer, if they have different local rules for their interactions, you see very different structure for the information flows, which motivates me to think about this idea of physical emulation of life in terms of the kinds of systems that are not alive but display lifelike properties. And so we're thinking about these kind of physical isomorphisms or mapping a coarse-grained representation, a macro state from biology onto another system. The basic idea here is that we know that oil droplets can display lifelike behavior like swarming, or like this one that takes on morphology that looks kind of like a jellyfish. And so what we're trying to do is basically take algorithms from collective behavior in living systems, like a flock of birds. You can train like a neural network to build a predictive algorithm for that, and then evolve the oil droplets to satisfy the same predictive formalism. And then you would basically be able to say that those two systems, a system with no agency, no logic, no intelligence, is basically displaying the same collective behavior as a system that has agency and intelligence, at least as far as we recognize it, and then build tests for seeing if you could tell the difference. And so one of the systems we could use for that is actually the ant behavior, but this is kind of one of the things that we're thinking about. And so this robot is being built now in Glasgow, and we're trying to work on raising things to actually do this project. So with that, I'm going to thank my research group because they're amazing. I am incredibly lucky to work with some very brilliant postdocs and grad students. Thank you. Thank you.